Welcome, welcome everyone. For hours and hours and hours this evening, I've been churning my wheels, very nervous, very tense, very much into an effort to come up with what needs to be said. And it's not that easy. I can do it, but it may take me just a little bit of effort to get into it. So if you can just bear with this video, there's some very important subtle distinction to be made, and it's there. I just have to find a way to bring it out, and we can give it a try, and I expect it will work. Well, to put it directly, and then we'll have to work on the context. To say that we have forgotten what we are is not accurate, actually. This is a very subtle distinction, very important distinction. We haven't forgotten who we are. But then how do you then account for the fact that we seem to have forgotten what we are, right? This is the question. It's a big question. I put a lot of stock in what is said in A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words, because I'm able to corroborate it with my own life experiences, my own effort and contemplation and reason and intuition, etc. And just through a tremendous life effort, I'm able to just sort of able to gauge, you know, who's talking straight. You know, who really knows. And this information comes from what I can tell is someone who truly knows the truth. And the person that happens to, the being, the intelligence happens to say that it's Jesus. So I say, okay, no reason to dispute that. And he keeps making this distinction. Always he leads you here, and then he says, but it's, even that isn't it. And you're just like, wow, you know, it's so challenging. And so I would say, and what I'm saying is that even though it appears we have totally forgotten what we are, and we have this continuity problem to remember what we are, we haven't actually forgotten what we are, truly. We're spirit. We have been engaged in a project for a long time, which is to try and create differently than God. Okay, this is the project we've been engaged in, and it seems that in the effort of this project we have somehow forgotten what we are. But that is not quite true. It is not really true. And so this subtle distinction, I want to look at this, because it engages your mind in having to increase your clarity, all right, to be able to just to examine this. Let's examine this. What I'm saying is that what we are doing is we are trying to make time and space causative. Time and space causative. So that eventually we'll have some form in time and space, an appearance in time and space, whereby time and space will cause this form to be ignorant of its true creator. In other words, a complete failure to recognize its true creator. And it will have no choice but to believe it was created by time and space, that time and space is causative. So the project we're working on is really, we're working on time and space. And we're trying to make time and space causative. So we have this massive dream of belief that time and of evidence, and it seems to be evidence that time and space is causative. But it isn't. It actually isn't. And this is Jesus' central point. If you really boil it down to the highest clarity, he just hammers this home again and again and out. To believe that time is causative is to deny reality, is to deny the creator, it is to deny creation entirely. because there is no time and space in creation at all. Everything that is imagined, that is desired, that is willed, you can use whatever word you want. I tend to think will. What is it that I will to experience? Is instantaneous. The thought and the experience are one. There's no such thing as time and space. In terms of space, in terms of locations, relative to one another, having some sort of meaning at all. There is pure spaciousness in which ideas arise, seem to arise, but not the spaciousness of surrounding objects and forms that seem to be undergoing changes, etc. And what Jesus says is that there is no time in reality whatsoever. None. Everything is instant. And we seem to have the greatest difficulty to understand that, but I get it. I get it. After all these years, I read what he's saying. I get it. I understand what he's talking about. And I do agree with it. Now, I'm not as clear about it by any means, but I do side with that. I'm saying, yeah, I understand what he's getting at for sure. So we haven't changed what we are. And since we haven't changed what we are, how could we not know who we are? We do know who we are. But we're wrapped up in trying to get this project to work. And so we ignore what we are. It's not a matter of forgetting or not knowing. We ignore it. We say, yeah, but you know, so what? So what? we're trying to do something here, you know. Don't bug me. Don't bother me. And so we say we've forgotten, but we really haven't. We say, oh, yeah, I've really forgotten that. No, that's a ruse. That's part of the defenses, actually, that we use, is to say, I've forgotten. Okay, so this is a higher way of looking at the situation. We haven't forgotten. That's a lie. We have not forgotten. We know what we are. We do know what we are. So if we can accept this, this will remove a massive amount of delay from us, massive, because we're bringing to light that this whole notion of forgetting what we are is just another part of the defensiveness of saying, you know, it's still our desire to create differently than God. That's all it is. And we think, I just need more time. So I'm going to say I forgot who I am, and I need time to remember. It's not true. We don't need time to remember. See, this is a trick we're playing on, another trick that we're using. Lack of repentance. Continuity issue. See, I don't have a memory problem. I have a continuity problem. This is very important. I do not have a remembrance of what I am problem at all. I have a continuity problem. How can I have a remembrance problem when I am what I am right now? There's nothing to remember or forget. It is important. There's no time involved in it whatsoever. What I am is not involved in time in the slightest, time and space in the slightest bit, or even form. So there can't be a memory problem or a forgetfulness problem. There cannot be. So what is the problem? Continuity problem is what I say. Is we're just afraid that as we drop time, space, and form, trying to make it causal, and our perception is still there, we think, if we actually dropped it all, our perception would be dropped too, because perception is part of it. But we assume that we'll perceive an abyss. If it's all dropped, we'll be perceiving an abyss. It's not there anymore. We'll perceive. So we're terrified of that. That's the real abyss we're frightened of. We're frightened of that. It's not that we don't know who we are. It's that we're afraid of this continuity issue. That's how I see it. And the greatest success I've had is to work on this continuity problem and say, I don't have a remembrance problem. I have a continuity problem. When I was doing that, that's when I had the vision of oneness, for sure. I said, wow, this really, really, really works. So I'm looking to see, you know, how can I popularize this? How can I share it better? So I've been looking deeper and deeper and deeper into this issue. And I found that when we think we have a memory problem, this is the delusion. This is what we must deny, actually. And yet it seems like this is the high teaching of the world, like we just can't remember who we are. It's not true. We have a continuity problem. what I found is if we deny that we have a memory problem, a remembrance problem, and we insist that we have only a continuity problem, the vision of oneness actually opens for us. That's what I've personally experienced. Now, I haven't done that for a month or so, whatever. I sort of like said, wow, well, wait a minute, you know, why was this so successful? I've been trying to look and see, was this just, you know, just me? Or is it really the continuity? Is it really that successful? It's like, wow, is it possible? I believe it is. I really do believe it is. And it's just that we're not willing to do it because we have this fear of the abyss. I mean, a continuity problem is very severe. The abyss that we fear, I mean, Longchenpa, the great Tibetan Dzogchen master, said in his experience in this world, vast experience teaching spiritual students, and saying that the overwhelming problem is the fear of the abyss. But we assume that we're thinking the abyss is looking at reality and thinking it's an abyss. No, it's actually recognizing that time and space is not causal, and then feeling we're going to drop it, because obviously we cannot produce a perfect failure. We cannot time and space cannot cause anything intrinsically of reality to change at all. It cannot cause a failure for our creations to know what we are. We need to just drop all time and space and forms, yes. And then we think we'll perceive a void, an abyss. Of course, that's what we're thinking. But the whole point in teachers is to reassure us that's not so. Everything will still appear there. And so this is the whole point of what my sharing is about, is to keep working on these issues. Is we will not see a void, a lack of anything, everything disappear. That is not how it works. And I've done, you know, hundreds of videos focusing on that. And we still need more focus to bring in better focus. But at least we know that's where we fear the abyss is. So it's a huge help to see it there. We also know that this remembrance issue, claiming we can't remember, is a red herring that we're using out of the continuity fear. It is a red herring. We don't have a remembrance problem, we have a continuity problem. And it's the continuity fear that causes us to insist we have a remembrance problem. If there's no time, again, no time, space, and appearance at all, how could we, that which everything is instant, have a memory problem or remembrance problem? We can't. We cannot. Literally, we cannot. But we can desire to work on a project of trying to make time and space causal, which is really an attempt to fail, to cause our creations to fail to recognize what we are. And we want our creations to fail, to have a memory problem. You see, it's our desire that there be such a thing as a memory, a remembrance problem for our creations, not for us, but for our creations, that is making us think there's a remembrance problem. Because we want to create that. We want to create a remembrance problem. But we ourselves don't actually have one. This is the interesting realization. We want our creations to have a remembrance problem, a memory problem, a failure to remember, failure to communicate. And so we want to believe it's possible. And so we say, oh, sure, if it's possible for my creations, it's possible for me. But no, we don't really believe that, actually. We don't really have this problem. It's continuity problem all the way. Continuity problem all the way. All the way. And to the extent that we can accept this, this will open up the vision of oneness. And then that brings this holistic feeling that cannot be described in words, but we can use words to move our comfort zone close to it, which is why I've been using these very positive phrases and words to move our comfort zone, our familiarity in that direction. But ultimately, this totally holistic feeling is beyond words. because words are just symbols, arbitrary symbols, that only have meaning relative to other words. They don't have any absolute meaning of them in and of themselves at all. Not at all. Just like symbols don't have any actually real meaning. And being relative to other symbols, it means they depend on time and space. Whereas this holistic feeling is not dependent on time and space. It's entirely true right now, and has always been true. And it gives the lie to the belief that time and space is causal. It absolutely gives the lie to it. So what words can we use to describe the feeling of realizing that time and space is not causal at all, and never will be? What word can we use to that? And that's fantastic, because everything is one eternal life. We're all one family of eternal life. To know this, to feel it, what word can we use to actually, why should we even feel we need to describe it? To what? Why would we want to step it down? For the purpose of forgetfulness, right? Failure. We want our offspring to only, our creations, to only be able to not actually know, but to only talk about and symbolize and think about and intellectualize and dispute and argue and mythologize, or I can't even know. There's some word there. And we don't want them to know. So when we have this experience to say, oh my gosh, I don't want my offspring to know this. So let's move away from that, move away from it. So to that extent, words are a great hindrance. But because we've been using words for so long, I see it as possibly very helpful to use words to move us back closer to saying, there are no words. There are no words. I don't need words. The words are all an attempt to forget, actually. So our offspring, our creation that doesn't know its creator, will be stuck with just words, just with symbols. Symbols of reality, but no reality. And yet we do need to communicate to those who are still have the severe continuity problem. So on that level, you can see, okay, words at that level are words at that level. And then there's also beyond words. If we weren't in the world, then we wouldn't need to use words. But since we're here, as when in Rome, do as Romans do, we use words. But we do need to use words to point to the wordless, to the totality, to the non-problem of forgetfulness, to the non-problem of failure, to the fact we only have a continuity problem. We haven't made time causal for anything. We have not made time causal for anything whatsoever. Every moment is being imagined in the mind as a complete, total moment. Amazing as that may sound, such is our creativity. Each moment, this is like a sort of a collective delusion, but it's all taking place in the mind. Each moment is free and clear of every other moment. There isn't any actual quote-unquote time and space. Not really. It's an illusion. It's a perceptual illusion, and it's a belief of ours. It's a desire for that to be. But this very moment, right now, is the only moment there is. It is not tied to the future. It is not tied to the past. The past does not determine this moment at all. And this moment does not determine the future at all. Not in the slightest bit. There is no causality of time and space. And so this is the heavy, heavy truth and message that Jesus is actually bringing us. And we know it to be true, but we don't want our offspring to know it to be true. You see? This is the trouble. And then we realize that we can never have any creations that can be ignorant of its creator. Then we say, oh, to heck with this whole thing. That we don't need it at all. And then we say, oh my God, I'm going to see an abyss. So, seems like we keep check meeting ourselves. Now, I stopped doing the continuity exercise on videos because I sound like a broken record, you know, over and over and over and over and over. But it was supremely effective, supremely effective. Especially working on this whole issue of remembrance. I do not have a remembrance problem, I have a continuity problem. I do not have a forgetfulness problem, I have a continuity problem. And assert that with vigor, absolute, you know, vigor of certitude. I do not have any forgetfulness problem. The only problem I have is the continuity problem. The forgetfulness problem has absolutely no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value. This practice is what actually worked for me. Till the vision of oneness dawned upon me. This is the practice that worked. Now, what happened was, I said, well, how come it didn't last? And so now I've been saying, oh, wait a minute, I need to get comfortable with just how wonderful it is and have a way to relate to other people. There must be a way. So then I went to work on all this terminology and I've been practicing that. So I hope the two together, the two practices together will result in a stable, you know, vision of oneness. That's my goal. I have reason to believe it will. That's the aim. So since we don't have a forgetfulness problem, what we are, we definitely, everyone understands what I'm saying, what's being said here, absolutely. It's just we're saying, yeah, I get it, but I don't want my creations to get it. So how do I make them forget? And so we keep working on forgetfulness. So we're working on forgetfulness for our creations, but we're not forgetfulness ourselves, you see. This is the tricky situation. But if we can recognize that we are trying to create differently than God creates, so that we can claim that we are a prime creator. See, we're the prime creator because we're creating differently. So that's our goal. So we're trying, as God's creations all know God and can never forget God, we're trying to create a creation that doesn't know us, doesn't know God, doesn't know us, and will never know us. And so we're working on this whole idea of forgetfulness, of failure to know what we are, failure to know what is, failure to know reality. We're trying to fail. We're working on failure for our offspring. we can't get it. We can't fail ourselves. We know that. But we believe we can create something that is a failure to know us. And time and space is crucial, especially time. Time. The idea that cause can take time to have effect is the central delusion. In reality, cause and effect are one. So we don't have this duality of cause and effect at all. Except creation goes in one direction from the prime creator. But that's a given. But in terms of time, cause and effect, there's no such thing. It's instant. No gap. But what we're working on is to say that a cause happens now and then an effect happens later. So we think that what we're doing now is causing the future. The future is not caused, actually. It's not caused at all. It's only the moment that is caused. And it's instantaneous. You see, that's what we don't see. Our perception can't see instantaneousness. We don't realize that this moment is instantaneous. Because we're looking for it in time. We're saying, well, how fast is it? How fast is instantaneous? Where words are measurements, are they not? Just some type of measurement. Say, well, this is great. You know, well, how great? You know, how long did it take to be great? You know, how fast is instantaneous? Is what we would say, you know, is it like 1 second or half a second? No, there's no time at all. And so that's where words stop, right? When we say no time at all, that's where words stop, at least words that relate to time. Now, the words that I'm using are to use words that are timeless, to evoke, there's no time involved in these phrases, in the phrases that you, the words that I'm using in the exercises. They point to timelessness. That's the whole issue, is they point to, what is instantaneousness? The prolific, teeming profuseness of instantaneousness. They point to instantaneousness, which doesn't have any time into it at all. And so we can use words to say, wait a minute, time is not causal. Instantaneousness is the truth. And I'm just need, I got this continuity fear, so I'm kind of just using words to kind of encourage myself and kind of melt the fear away. So that's what we're trying to do here. The absolute brilliance, you know, it gives a sense of right now. Absolute brilliance. The scintillating, you know, just the, it's something that is immediate. It's immediateness. It, words that have this, evoke the immediateness of the non-causality of time and space. And to the extent that we can evoke that, I believe it is helpful. Now, the continuity practice is I feel, you know, it's more powerful in terms of bringing us to the through the door of the vision of oneness, as it were. But evoking this instantaneousness is perhaps more helpful in maintaining the vision of oneness. I would put it that way. So it's kind of two different aspects. It's entering into it and then staying in it. So we're working on both here. We're working on both, entering into it and staying in it. And I've entered into it before, but I didn't stay in it. So what I want is to enter into it and stay in it. Now, I did work with eidetic imagery when I go down, lie down, go to sleep. And sometimes all this incredible flow of imagery happens in your mind. And it gets to the point where you're seeing something and it looks real to you. And then suddenly it's a part of your mind says, wait, that's just an image, that's not real. And then poof, you know, it's like poof, it disappears like that. And you're like, it sort of fades away. And you say, wow. Now I really enjoyed the vividness and freshness and immediateness of that imagery. You know, it seemed timeless, it seemed so fresh. And then something in our mind says, whoa, that you're looking at something that's timeless. You don't want that. You want to look at something that fades away. And so instantly it fades away. It fades away for us. Well, what I found was I started using this term and saying, I would say it's like, this is so blessed. I feel the blessedness of this. This is so peaceful. I see the purity. This is so pure. I love the clarity of this. I love the purity of this. I love the purity. And as long as I was saying these felt kind of phrases, like, I love the absolute purity of this, the imagery didn't fade away. It did not fade away. It's like an incredible discovery. And so what I'm bringing to light right now is that our mind does have the capacity to see timelessness, to see things in a timeless way, actually, to see imagery in a timeless way, which is the genuine remembrance, quote-unquote remembrance of reality, meaning it solves the continuity problem for us, actually. It enables us to come out of our coma, as it were, a reflection, let's call it a reflection, a genuine reflection of reality. We have the capacity to do that, but because we want, this project has been to somehow make time and space causal, which means change that is linked. The future is based on the past, and there is a process of fading and of dying and disintegrating, and all this that is somehow free of instantaneousness, but inevitably happening. As if it's a causal, a process, a becoming. Because we want to have a creation that fails to know what created it, we the eidetic imagery, when it becomes crystal clear and untouched by any process, we suddenly say, oh, whoa, 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 we can't have this. And poof, it starts to fade, gradually fade away, like a bubble bursting or something like that. That's why it happens. Is we fall back into the old way, the old ways of believing that we want to make time and space and process, time and space causal, meaning process, linked process, instead of instantaneous moments of absolute freedom. And yet I found a way to stop this. Now, I've only done it once, but it worked. It really worked. And I was using these terms that I put up in practicing. I love this pure clarity. You know, I love this wordlessness. I love this everlastingness. I love this complete, clean freshness. I love this tracelessness. And I kept saying, I love this baseless, you know, purity. I love these. I use these absolute abstract terms and saying that I love this, and it stayed there for me. It stayed. And I was like, wow, this never happened before. I said, this is wonderful. Just, I want you to just stay there. Don't go away. Don't go away. This has been the challenge of my life. I have all this beautiful inner imagery that is timeless, and then it, poof, it goes away. I say, whoa, 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 don't go away. It always goes away. And so the key is, do not try to grasp it. Do not try to contain it, to hold on to it. Rather, express your love for it in these terms. I absolutely adore. This is absolutely divine. I love how divine this is. I absolutely adore this, and use these phrases of love for this imagery and appreciation and gratitude. Say, oh, I'm so grateful to see this. I'm absolutely, and keep repeating it, repeating it, repeating it. And what I found is it didn't fade away. It didn't fade away. But I was so amazed by this that I stopped repeating it, you know, and then it faded away. I said, what happened here? Oh my God, this works. So I would say that working on these words is super helpful. I would say that from my own experience, is that at some point you will suddenly click and say, hey, let me try using these words. And you will find that a vision of purity, this timeless vision, will not fade. This imagery that appears to you to be immortal and timeless and unaffected by process entirely won't fade away. And in that moment that you see that, you will know that you've discovered, you know, the Holy Grail, as it were. You've discovered the Holy Grail. And they say, wow, 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 wow. And then the reverberations, the shock of that, you know, it takes a while to process this. But I'm giving a context and a language that we can talk about this, because it's there for us. It is absolutely there for us. Time and space is a mirage. It's a delusion. Death is all decay. Death. All this stuff is. We are not dying. We are simply imagining all this death and decay, instant by instant by instant by instant. And if all there is to this entire universe is just this instant, and all there is to that is our desire to try to make time and space causal, and all there is to that is our desire to create different than God, which all there is to that is our desire to be prime creator, and all there is to that is a whim, and all there is to that whim is nothing, because it's not possible. You know, how trapped are we really? Are we really trapped by anything? Is there really decay and death, etc., or is there only an image of it? Is there only an image of it, this instant? And if we could see this image, this instant, as totally fresh and clean and traceless and baseless and not tied to the past in any way and not determining the future in any way, this is what Jesus calls the collapsing of time, or the holy instant. And if we can see it, just this instant, that way, and each instant that way, by saying, I love this, I love this, love this, and having this gratitude for it, gratitude, 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 that then reflects to us the true nature of reality, you see, and solves the continuity problem for us. You know, the whole world looks just incredibly beautiful at that point. And from moment to moment to moment, we keep the appreciation and gratitude of it. Each moment is fresh and clean like that for us. And it's like a miracle. It's a miracle. We're not experiencing the world the way that others believe that they're experiencing it anymore. And this is the cure. This is the sovereign cure, actually. And it's not out of reach at all. In fact, it's very much in reach. We just simply haven't applied it. I never even tried using this gratitude for this. I'm so grateful that I'm seeing this. I'm so grateful I'm seeing this. I can, and it stayed. Never tried before. So it just simply matter. It's not difficult. It's a matter of never even trying it. I was just hoping before. It's like, oh, okay. Now I hope this doesn't fade. Hoping, instead of saying, I know, we can say even more, I know this is the reflection of reality that I so cherish. This is the reflection of reality that I am so grateful for. I am so grateful for this reflection of reality. And I just stayed in this emotional, a feeling state. I feel so grateful for this reflection of reality. And as I stayed in this state of feeling gratitude, it remained with me. It remained with me. So, this is an open secret now. It's the secret of secrets. It's the Holy Grail, and it's an open secret now. So we are not trapped. We are not trapped at all. The answer is quite simple. I have a continuity problem, and then expressing the gratitude for this, seeing the holy instant. Okay, expressing the gratitude and seeing imagery, everything seeming to be just untouched by process, by time and space, any causation of time and space, untouched by any process. It in the now, it has this eternal feeling. You know, it's just like wonderful. It looks different to us. It looks different to us because what we're seeing, as Jesus tells, we're only seeing our own thoughts about everything. And our thoughts are thoughts about causation of time and space, believing the past determines the future. So we're not actually seeing what is here, is it what Jesus tells us. When we're perceiving, we're seeing mental, thought-based images. We're not seeing what is actually here at all. But we can see what is actually here, actually. We can see it. And that is the baseless, traceless, absolutely fresh, clean, and pure, clear, effortless, timeless, wordless, full of grace, divinely full of grace, effortless reflection, here and now reflection of the instantaneousness of reality. And so we can make this a little bit clearer as we go along. We will. It's not as difficult as we think. Our thoughts are making us think it's difficult because we say, well, what's the process involved? There is no process involved. You say, well, how do you link it to the past? You don't link it to the past. Well, how do you make it in the future? You don't make it in the future. You simply are grateful for the now of it. You see, this moment is not determining the future. The future is not determined at all, and not really. But we can know what's going to happen in the future only because looking at our thoughts and what we think the past, how the past is determining the future, then we can know what we're going to choose the future to be like, the moments, moment by moment by moment. It can be extrapolated that way, but it's not a given because we can change our mind, decide we're going to collapse time instead and give up this ridiculous quest to create a creation that doesn't know its creator. So you couldn't say the future is absolutely determined, but you can also say that it's highly likely that the moments of the future will be like this, but not because they're joined to the past, but because we're trying to make them join, make the future join to the past, but they're not joined. We're trying to join what can't be joined. We're trying to do it. So in other words, we're trying to make time, space, form, causality of time and space, and process real. There's a process here, even though there isn't. So we're very determined and habituated to doing this. So it's likely we'll continue to be determined and habituated, at least most of us. So it's likely, this is a likely future, even though it is not set in stone at all. It's set in habit, yes. It's set in desire, yes. But that too is not actually set in stone. No. So just the ability to consider these issues expands your, what would you say? Your brilliance. It expands. It melts your continuity fear, is another way to put it. It reassures you. It expands your reassurance. It expands your reassurance, and you say, "Wow, I don't believe I'm really stuck like I thought before. No way, no way." And then all the ruminations of those who feel they are stuck, it's just flat for you. It's just completely flat. I just can't pay attention to it hardly. I don't value it all, other than amusement or way to spend some time or something. But just no. It's not. Though the talk of those who really believe that they're trapped is just not interesting at all. It has no juice to it whatsoever. It's like we have this cat we're trying to keep in the house as young, but it wants to get out real bad. And we finally started letting it out. And once it, you know, realized it could get out, you know, you know, the cat's out of the bag, so to speak. And it's not interested in staying in the house all day. It says, "Hey, I want outside. You know, that's where it's happening for me as a cat. You know, and I'll sleep at night. And let me out, and I want to climb trees, and I want to move around. I want to, you know, do my thing as a cat." So once we realize, you know, these fundamental truths, you know, we don't want to stay locked up in the house of ignorance anymore. We don't want to stay sleeping inside the house of ignorance any longer. It just doesn't interest us. It just really doesn't. It's lost its interest. It's lost its capacity to spellbind us. And the plans that delusion and ignorance has for us don't interest us either. They really don't. I believe that the protection comes from disinterest. I really do. Because you don't struggle. You say, I'm just not interested in going along with any of your plans, you know. And they're nasty plans, let me tell you. Very nasty plans, but I'm just not interested. I'm telling you, the best defense is disinterest. I mean, that's how I believe Jesus. I always wonder why Jesus did not tell us about what's going on in this world. You know, the Course in Miracles was first really put into readable format in 1972, whereas people, I believe, were reading it in 1972. And, you know, that was pre-high technology, right? Pre-high technology. That was before it all really got going. And since then, so much has changed, and you know, the whole hybridization program, you know, was not really out in the open as much, which is the Zeta Reticulans coming to Earth and saying this sob story about how they've ruined their planet is no longer habitable, and they need another planet, and they, can you help us out, and we'll give you technology if we're allowed to hybridize, and they want this world to be a world where their hybrids continue on. Actually, they said that their own DNA is dying, and they're dying out as a race, and they want themselves to continue on through hybridization with humans and Zeta Reticulans, and have this planet a place where their hybrids continue on still their civilization. And that's what this whole technology thing, this whole world is all about now, actually. That's where it's going. It was pre that. It was before all that. And so Jesus never addressed any of it. And in the subsequent talks with Dr. Brent Haskell, for instance, Journey Beyond Words and The Other Voice, and I don't know if he's talked with anyone else or not, actually. Some say that he has. Some say that he is doing so. I'm not going to say one or the other about that. But it's not addressed these issues of the internet so much, and the computers and hybridization program of the Zeta Reticulans, and the involvement in this planet with different extraterrestrial groups, the Nordics, the reptilians, and some other ones, the likely, there's no question of the domination of the world by the banksters, by the secret organizations. Whether Homo capsaicins are running the show or not is something that is open to, you know, question. For sure, it is very possible. Those with extreme intellect, extreme mathematical wizards, etc., with a higher brain capacity, are running the show. And are these the remnants of past civilizations, past people on the planet? Are they hybrids, actually hybrids? You know, is the question, etc. He didn't address any of this. And the fact that those who want to create time and space as causation that will cause a creation to be unaware that of reality, that time and space isn't causal, that they're so into it that they want to completely annihilate those who realize this isn't true, that time and space is not causal. He didn't address that either, but that is certainly in play big time. There's a extreme war against spirituality, against religion, against deep understanding on this planet. There's a plan to absolutely shred them up entirely, all bodies that believe that, because they think that these bodies are prototypes, and they believe that bodies are the ones believing this, and not spirit, you see. They think thought comes from bodies. That spirit comes from bodies. So those bodies that still believe in spirit and that time is not causative, they think those are defective bodies and defective DNA and defective genetics. And so they want to get rid of those bodies, and they want to, like, you know, shred them. I mean, they have great, you know, animosity towards those bodies that they think believe that. But in fact, bodies don't believe anything. Bodies don't think anything. It's mind, it's spirit that's thinking. But they don't see it that way at all. So they think that attacking bodies gets rid of this, you know, faulty prototype, which is, you know, utter delusion. And yet they are very, you know, intense into this. Now, he doesn't address any of that. And I'm always criticized. I complain. I complain to Jesus a lot. I say, Jesus, why haven't you addressed any of this? That is just unbelievable. You know, it's just incredible. I don't understand it at all. I really don't get it, because this is what's happening. This is what's going on the planet. The goddess of destructivity is in full play right now, meaning that the desire, the attempt to succeed at failure, is now so intense that the archetype, we've imagined there's some goddess, a great mother, that is the one who is an authority of all over all this and is going to assure we succeed. It's like saying that God wants us to succeed. See, now God doesn't, because God knows that it would reality be annihilated. So God does not want to succeed, and God knows it cannot. It's not God's will. But we want to succeed so badly, we insist that God really does want us to succeed, but we realize God doesn't. So what do? We imagine another God. We call it the goddess, the great mother of time and space and form. Okay, and we worship this goddess. And we believe this goddess will empower us to succeed at total failure. Okay? Succeed at failure. And so we've invited the energy of this goddess, as it were, which is just a projection, to this planet in some form, actually. Whether it's many forms on this planet, but it may be invested also in one particular heavyweight goddess form. And we'll believe that she's God. And this goddess is here now, in form, I believe, because I experienced in a subtle vision this her coming into this world, and she was, you know, the most ferocious entity I've ever encountered, without question, and the most intensely ferocious and focused and absolutely determined to kick butt here, you know, absolutely kick butt, and absolutely shred any bodies that do not worship her and believe that she, that we can succeed in being, you know, bringing total failure to reality, for our creations to totally fail to recognize us. She is here to absolutely shred any resistance. And she means business, I'm telling you. And she's going about implementing the capacity to do this. So I say, Jesus, I know all this. So you're not addressing this at all. You know, that causes me a problem. You know, why are you not addressing any of this? And so I would say the answer to this is that Jesus would tell us, as just the Holy Spirit has sort of informed me now, is disinterest is the best defense. Disinterest is the best defense. It's not that Jesus is unaware of all this. He's just giving us the best defense for all of this, which is just disinterest. I'm not interested at all. And so how does disinterest come? By focusing on truth instead of focusing on all this terrible stuff that's happening. Is simply be disinterested in it. I'm not interested at all. I don't care that the mother goddess is here on this planet. The great goddess is here, you know, the great mother is here, and that she plans to physically shred those who don't worship her. I'm not interested in that. It has no interest in whatsoever to me. And it's this disinterest that is the best defense. Jesus actually says total defenselessness is the best defense. But what is total defenselessness? Where does that come from? Total disinterest. I have no interest. It doesn't interest me at all in any regard. I'm not interested in trying to succeed at failure. It doesn't interest me. How does that come about? By getting a glimpse of a vision of oneness. That's how it comes about. And knowing that you can keep that steady and working on this problem, this issue, this continuity issue, by making the continuity issue your interest, everything else you're no longer interested in. And by not being interested in it, it protects you from it. This is, I believe, what Jesus knows, and which is why he's never given me any information like, how come you're not commenting on all this, the internet and the technology, hybridization, blah, 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 blah. There's so much stuff involved in all this, because he knows disinterest is the best defense. So he's working to get us interested in something else, which is the vision of oneness. We cannot exist in a vacuum. We're going to be interested in something. He knows that. So if we are not interested in a vision of oneness, for sure we're going to be interested in all this terrible stuff that's going on. And that terrible stuff is going to eat us up, you know, because it feels we're defective because we have a somewhat of a lack of interest in it. It's going to chew the body up, as it were. And if, you know, failed prototype, failure. You know, you failed to succeed at failure is what they will say. But if you have no interest in it whatsoever, you know, it just passes you by. That's the real Passover. That's the real Passover. I say sidestepping. You can say Passover, which was the Jewish, you know, tradition of Passover. High holiday is based on this. Is there the whole idea of Jews is to, they're supposed to be interested in truth, reality, in that time and space is not causal. And this is the whole principle of Passover, is that if your blood is on your door, meaning it means if your interest, see, blood relates to interest, really, to focus attention, interest ultimately. The ancients felt that blood contained our desire, our interest, okay? So if your interest, your blood, is on the vision of oneness, then the world, the attempt to kill you, to shred you, will pass you by. That's real Passover. Now, Jesus celebrated the Last Supper on, wasn't it like during Passover? I'm sure it was, right? It was during Passover, because he was celebrating the unleavened bread, right? The feast of Passover. And he said, eat this unleavened bread, right? What non-causality of time and space is the unleavened bread. And that is now celebrated in communion in Roman Catholicism. in remembrance of Jesus. Do this in remembrance of me. This is lack of interest in time and space and trying to develop causality of time and space. No more interest in that. You're interested in the unleavened bread of the vision of oneness, of the nowness, of the instantaneousness. You see, yeast takes time to leaven bread, whereas unleavened bread is right now. It's the instantaneousness of it, of right now. It is this moment, this holy instant. The communion wafer symbolizes the holy instant of right now, collapsed time, you see. It says, do this in remembrance of what I was telling you. So the real Jews are the ones who are still celebrating Passover, who are still working to get their attention, their interest on the holy instant, on the holy instant, on the non-causality of time and space. Those are the true Jews who are still listening to Jesus, who are still celebrating the whole principle of Passover, right? The unleavened bread, daily, daily. So what Roman Catholicism was trying to do, was supposed to do, and has tried to do, celebrate Mass daily. This symbolizes that every day is a celebration of Passover. Every day. Every day we should be saying, this is Passover day, where the efforts to make time and space causal pass me over, and the efforts to shred my body into a billion pardon dust particles passes me over because I have no interest in it. So it's a continual practice. It's not just Passover once a year, it's Passover every day. And what Jesus said, I'm bringing a New Testament, but he did bring it to the Jewish people. And because they had, somehow they had the focus, or the blood, the focus, the interest in this. There was those who were interested in this. And he said, I'm bringing a New Testament. Okay, a New Testament. And he wanted us to celebrate the unleavened bread, the Passover feast, every day. Or every moment, ultimately. Every moment. Which is why he did not go with the Old Testament laws. He broke the Old Testament laws. He said, I'm not to uphold all those laws, but to give a New Testament. And yet it was set in the context of the principles of the Old Testament, the Passover principles. He definitely set it in within that principle. If you can understand this, the blood means the interest. What am I interested in? What am I focused on? This is an attempt to put the whole thing in the right context, the whole situation in the right context. Now, this ritual was designed to as a smelling salts for us. But we really are called to more than that. We're called to more to going, you know, the ritual of going to Mass once a week or once a day or something. We're called to actual work on this continuously, which is what I do. It's all about working about where your interest is. Where is your interest? What are you truly interested in? Are you interested? Are we interested in trying to succeed at failure? Trying to make failure a success, trying to succeed at making true failure? Is that what we're interested in? Are we interested in setting failure down, setting this effort down, setting failure down and saying, it can never work because it's not God's will? Are we interested in doing that? Those are the two options we have. We can maintain an interest in trying to succeed at failure, or we can turn our interest to setting failure down. Those are the two options we have. Those are the only two options we have. And those who want to continue to work at being a success at failure have a very nasty view of those who want to set failure down. There's no question about that. They feel that their failed prototypes, that their bodies need to be annihilated because we need to be discarded as quickly as possible, you know, because they say, oh, time and space is not causal. Oh my God, we need to get rid of them quickly. They're going to contaminate the whole experiment, that kind of thing. So we do need to work on the notion of oneness. We do need to work at that. And our defense is our lack of interest in failure. That's our defense. And of course, those who work on failure say, no, that doesn't work. That's a failure, they say. No, it's not. It's a success. It's a success. And Jesus said, no one could, said none of you could harm a hair on my head if I didn't agree for you to do that. You couldn't harm me in the slightest bit, because I got no interest in that. But I'm going to let you, you know, do what you want to do for the purpose to showcase the resurrection and to showcase that you're just working at the level of body is not causative, that time and space is not causative to spirit at all. You see, it's only relative to other symbols. Simple. Illusions seem to affect other illusions. They don't affect reality whatsoever. So, disinterest is our best defense, and that is why Jesus doesn't get into what's going on at all. He doesn't get into it. And I guess I gotta stop bugging him to get into it, because he's just not gonna do it. You know, he's just not gonna do it. He's not gonna do it, because then we'll get interested in it. He doesn't want us interested in all that stuff. He wants us interested in the vision of oneness. He wants us, say, practicing this continuity practice. See, I don't have a remembrance problem, I have a continuity problem. He wants us to be able to hold this moment in our mind's eye, moment by moment, which is to express gratitude and appreciation to it moment by moment. That's what he wants for us. So he wants our interest there. So that's what I'm trying to do, is to keep our interest there. And still not denying what's going on in the world, okay? Not at all. I've always said I do not deny how these moments are trying to be sequenced. There's no question that the world is an incredibly nasty place now. And there's no question that the world wants to exterminate the prototypes, that the quote-unquote prototypes, bodies that seem to be speaking about disinterest in time and space. There's no question that is true. There's no question that the hybridization program has been taking place in secrecy, somewhat secrecy, and that this world is being conditioned, brainwashed into accepting this as the hybrids as the new true owners of this planet, and that those who are here in this planet are supposed to serve them, to obey them, to serve them, to be their slaves, to accept them as their rulers, their masters. Actually, there's no question that that is going on. There's no question that a whole lot of stuff is going on in this world. The desire to make a new world order is going on. The collapse of the fiat currency is going on. World War III, trying to instigate that, is going. All this stuff is taking place. There's no question about it. I don't deny any of that. And I'm sure Jesus would not deny it either. But the cure is disinterest in it. That's the cure. And I guarantee all of you that when the vision of oneness dawns upon you, you will say, this is what you're truly interested in. Without any question, you will say, this is what I truly want. And the other stuff is like a faint, faint, pale shadow. Anything else is like a faint. All the so-called events in time and space are like a faint, faint, fading shadow. At the very most, you will say, this is what I really, really want. Without any question whatsoever. For sure, you will feel that way, for sure. So the goal is to get that dawning of the vision of oneness. That's got to be the goal. And that's the goal that Jesus sticks to. Absolutely, just he's absolutely sticks to that and just keeps sticking to it, sticking to it. So I would say, if anyone wants to help Jesus, help our salvation, help the Passover, is to keep sticking with that goal, keep sticking with it, but without denying the intensity of the times and the pressure of the times and the fact that we really got to get after it, because all this nastiness is here. It's really nasty, the world, more than we realize, for sure. way more than we realize. And if we start trying to see what's going on, it'll scare us, actually. It scares me. When I'm very frightened how nasty it is. But what is the perfect defense? Perfect disinterest in it. Perfect disinterest. Because it takes two to tango, you see? Because we choose our experiencing moment by moment. And if we're totally disinterested in that, we won't experience that. We will not experience what their plans are for us because they can't convince us to experience it. We'll say, I'm not interested in that. I'm not interested in dancing with you. I'm sitting this dance out. No, I got something that's way more interesting. And then that your experiencing will be the vision of oneness and the security and the peace and the beauty of that. That's what will be your experience. And your body will be totally protected. Absolutely. Just as Jesus said, you can't touch a hair on my head if I didn't agree to that this would be my experience. So we will be safe, we will be protected simply through our total disinterest in what's going on in the world and our total interest in the vision of oneness, saying, yeah, this is a celebration. And so we celebrate. We talk this way, we celebrate this way. We use the language of the vision of oneness. We use the language to put our interest there. And to become disinterested in what's going on in the world with all their words and language and all this nasty, 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 nasty stuff that they're using. We don't use that anymore. We use a language of love. We use a language of gratitude. We use the language of appreciation. We use the language of everything going off script. We use the language of collapsing all time into the holy instant. We use the language of experiencing this and how great it is. That's what we use the language of. And that keeps our interest there, keeps the Passover principle working for us, you see. So that's what we have to do. That's what we do. But we do it because that's what we want to do. That's where our interest is. All right. So we've covered a lot of territory here, super important territory. And so my work is done for the day, and your attention is done, but the reverberations go on, and we can keep with what we are interested in. We keep focused on it. All right. Very great. That's it for this one.